I know that life can hurt you. Believe me, I've been there. We let each other down and pretend that we don't care. But love will reveal that old wounds can heal. Open your heart and take a chance. Oh man,
I'll be your brother, you'll be my friend. We'll lean on each other through thick and through thin.
You're standing the gap, I've got your back.
Wow. That's Micah Stampley and Michael O'Brien singing the song Brothers and Friends. I'm Pastor Bruce Wall, and I'm in the studio live today and preparing for another great broadcast that's going to touch the hearts of many people in the city of Boston and many others around the world. This morning, we have 2 hours to be with you before we go to Newark, New Jersey and Chattanooga, Tennessee with the three young men. And then coming up at 10 o'clock will be Siddiqui Cambone with the Black Power Hour. But this morning, I decided that I wanted to spend some time talking with you about the gentrification conference that's coming up here in the city of Boston on Saturday, May 7th, starting at 9 a.m. and going to 1 p.m. 9 o'clock in the morning and going to 1 p.m. It's a conference. It's a four-hour conference that will take place right here on Boston Praise Radio and TV. So it's the type of conference that means that you do not have to leave your house. Isn't that great? You can be a part of the conference right where you are. You can stay home. You could be at work. You could be in your car. And you'll be able to listen to the conference from the beginning all the way to the end. Now, one of the questions is, why are we having a conference in Boston entitled The Status of the Black Church in Boston in the Midst of the Gentrification of the City? Well, we decided that we wanted to assist as many churches as we can because it's our understanding that there are a number of churches that could be in jeopardy of losing their property, their storefronts that they may not own. And we need to be forearmed. We need to be prepared. We need to be ready to understand what's happening in our city and what we can do to prepare for what's taking place in Boston. I want to give you my telephone numbers. It's 617-282-0685. Now, when black folk were living in downtown Boston and we had an opportunity to move from downtown Boston into the South End, my assumption is that many people thought that the move, good morning, Phyllis Leslie, that the move to the South End was a blessed move, a great move, a great opportunity for us. But then we didn't understand what was really going on. Let me read a definition of gentrification. Gentrification is the phenomenon of affluent folk moving into less wealthy neighborhoods, renovating the homes and attracting new businesses. Or, as summed up by the Centers for Disease Control, gentrification is often defined as the transformation of neighborhoods from low value to high value. Gentrification is taking place in every city across the country, especially urban cities, urban communities where the housing stock has not been renovated, where stores and businesses are closed, and people have abandoned those neighborhoods. Wealthy people are buying up the property. They are developing the property and creating new communities that really, really, these communities do not include us if you are financially not capable of paying the exorbitant rents. I was told in Boston that there is an apartment that is renting for $7,000. We all know that there are apartments renting for $3,000 and $4,000, but $7,000 a month rent for an apartment? Wow. So we want to have this conference, the status of the Black church in Boston in the midst of gentrification of the city. The reason why, again, we want to have it is that we want to alert and we want to work with the community, because I believe that if we do not warn our brothers and sisters about what's about to happen, if we do not warn them, we're going to have so many churches in Boston who might have to consider closing or relocating. And the relocation bothers me, because on the relocation, what I'm seeing is many churches deciding that they cannot make it in Boston any longer. And I believe that many of these churches are going to choose to close their doors, and they're going to follow where their people are going. They're going to follow where their congregations are going. There are churches around the country that are closing, that their membership has gone. One church, their membership went down from 1,200 people on the day that they closed to 5 people. The senior population has been moved out of the city, and the seniors were driving back into the city to attend the church of their youth. But because there are permit parking signs all around their churches, they were ticketed and some of their cars were towed. And so many of the seniors decided that they no longer would drive into the city to attend their church. And so churches are having their congregations shrink every single Sunday. The church benches are no longer as full as they used to be. Now, I've only had 3 church experiences. My first church experience was 12th Baptist Church. My second church experience was a church that we founded at the Shaver Roller Skating Rink. And my third church is this church, Global Ministries Christian Church. At 12th Baptist Church, the congregation was so full on Sundays that they had to put chairs in the middle aisle. The chairs had to go from the front to the back, and the service started at 11 a.m., and by 10:30, the church was filled to capacity. That is amazing, and I'm not seeing that phenomenon anymore in some of the churches that I've attended, and I don't see that phenomenon taking place at 12th Baptist Church anymore. So, again, we're going to have a conference, and the conference is entitled The Status of the Black Church in Boston in the Midst of the Gentrification, because we have to talk about this, because if we don't talk about this, we're going to leave our churches and our communities left without any way of finding their way out of, and I want to thank Jamal for the link that he just sent me. He sent me a link that focuses on gentrification, and a link that I'll look at and utilize for my next program. Now, I want to give you some of the topics, and I want to give you the time. It's Saturday, May 7th, 9 a.m. Saturday, May 7th, 9 a.m. You do not have to come to the radio station or the church for the conference. You can stay in your homes and watch it live in your living room, in your bedroom, on your job. You can watch it going to work. You can watch it on tablets and on your phones and on your computers and on your televisions. It's being made very convenient for you to be able to watch this. The first topic that will start at 9:10 is we want to talk about the migration of black people from downtown Boston to the South End, then to Roxbury, Dorchester, and Mattapan. What was the migration all about? Why did people migrate? Why did they leave downtown Boston and come to the South End? Were they forced? Were they encouraged? Were they told it's a better place? Why did they move? And then, how did they move people from the South End into Roxbury, Dorchester, and Mattapan? Why would people leave the South End and move to Roxbury, Dorchester? So we want to talk about that history. Number two, at 10 o'clock. We're going to ask the question, is gentrification the new urban removal? Is gentrification the new urban removal? We used to call urban renewal urban removal because the city was actually taking eminent domain. They were taking people's property and saying, well, we need to build in this area. So we're going to give you this amount of money. Your house is valued at this amount. We're going to give you this money so we can build here. Or a highway is coming through here. Or the taxes have gone up. You haven't paid your taxes. You're behind in your taxes. Or they just offer an exorbitant amount of money for your property, and you choose to take the money and leave. Is gentrification the new urban removal? Because whenever we talk about gentrification or urban renewal or use those terms, it really means that the city administration wants the land, the property, and they're finding a legal way to move people out. Good morning, Eric Kennedy. Also, at 11 a.m., our next topic is going to be entitled, Will the Churches Be Removed from the City? Will the churches be removed? Now look, my church is located in Cobham Square. There are three churches in Cobham Square that have closed their doors. One church rented their space out to CVS, and CVS now occupies the space where that church was located. The second church moved out, and they have been trying to lease their facility for the past maybe 2 to 3 years, and they haven't been able to lease it yet. The third church is on the Ashmont Hill and Cobham Square line, and it is a church that is being renovated, and it's going to become a condo. That's three churches that are now gone, and I believe that we're going to see other churches go because pastors are going to follow their churches. Let me say it again. Pastors are going to follow their churches. Good morning. Caller, go ahead. You're live on the air.
Oh, yeah. This is Tony Greer.
Yes.
Hey, Pastor. How are you?
I'm doing well. How you doing?
Not too bad. I just was listening in, chiming in and, on this gentrification thing here.
Okay.
Yeah, and I just don't see why people are, you know, we're talking about it, which is a good thing.
Yeah.
But there's no action being formed.
Yep.
You know, I think if a group of 30 or 40 or more people got together and went down to City Hall and marched on the fact that there's no rent control and that they're continuing to just dismiss that and not talk about that, that's not being talked about amongst our legislators, the people we vote for.
Yeah.
And do the same at the State House as well for the legislators that run our districts, so to speak.
Yeah.
And why is it that, you know, the people who live here, you know, aren't being pushed out? You know what I mean? Why can't they, you know, do some legislative work to make sure that there's some rent control?
Well, here's one question. I had two questions for you. Number one, when is the last time you saw a black pastor in Boston lead anything in the streets? Number one. And when is the last time that you heard a black pastor on the radio or TV challenging the elected officials or doing anything to motivate and demobilize the black community to do for self? When is the last time you saw that?
I haven't. I haven't.
And therein lies part of the problem, because many of the activists, you know, when a person like Reverend Michael Haynes dies, and Jeep Jones dies, and Mel King is, they say, is not doing as well as he used to.
No, he's not.
Yeah, we can go on and on and on and name Chuck Turner, name all of these people that were leading. Okay, so they've aged out, they're dying. Who is left to speak to these issues and to mobilize our people? It's frightening to really think about it. What's going on?
It's going to take us to sit down and get the courage to do it, man. I mean, we're going to have to, man. You know, it can't just be we're waiting for the Chucks to come back, or we're waiting for the Mellors to come back. We need to lead by an example. Those guys set an example, and they set a blueprint for us.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Someone needs to, you know, get together with a few other people, and we need to take up this mantle, man. I mean, I'm not even going to go around and ask which reverend's going to, who may not be in the mayor's pocket or whatever. But we need to, sit down and start talking about this, man, you know, and start talking about how we can build this machine, well, man, this political machine.
Well, let me ask you a question, because it fascinates me, because there have been 1, 2, 3 migration moves, for example, and that may be the wrong term. So black folk used to live in downtown Boston around the State House. I know that because 12th Baptist Church and People's Baptist Church comes out of the black church that was a first African meeting house in downtown Boston. I understand we built a school there. We had a school, we had churches, we had homes. And then all of a sudden, and I don't know the history, and I'm trying to study it. Then all of a sudden, black folk were moved into the South End. So they were moved from Beacon Hill. So I want to know, were they pushed out? Were they told that it's a better place for them to be? You know, I want to know how that happened. And the first time it happens, I can't blame the people. But then when we were pushed out of the South End into Roxbury, Dorchester, Mattapan, we should have seen the pattern from Beacon Hill to the South End, then into Roxbury, Dorchester, Mattapan. And there is no excuse for why we were sleeping for the past. We slept for 70 years. In Roxbury, Dorchester, Mattapan. Now, Roxbury, Dorchester, Mattapan, we've been pushed out of there, and a lot of us have gone to the South Shore. So, what is going on? Just a second.
It was a design plan, first and foremost. As your church, our church was on North Russell Street as well, Amy Zion, Columbus Ave, Amy Zion Church.
Yeah.
We migrated from North Russell Street in the West End, so to speak, and we got that building in 1892 from the Temple of Israel.
Wow.
Yes. And that you know, that's a part of our history as well. And as you know, yes, we did. Everyone migrated into the South End. There was a lot of rooming houses.
Yeah.
And then in the 80s, they transformed a lot of those rooming houses into living you know, they gutted out a lot of those buildings.
Yep.
Matter of fact, Betty Gibson had owned a lot of that property down there, was buying up all that property down there at that time, all the brownstones.
Wow.
And then from there, a lot of those buildings began to, that's when they started pushing people out with the rents weren't affordable. This was under the Menino administration. And then it goes even further, deeper than that. They started pushing us towards Dudley Street on up to Grove Hall, from Grove Hall to Mattapan.
Yes.
Now it's as you said, they're fixing up. They're coming in. They're able to afford the homes. They're fixing it up in the cities. The taxes, and nobody's saying nothing.
Stay right there. We have another call. Stay there. I have another caller to join us. Caller, go ahead. You're live on the air.
Good morning. This is Jamal. How you doing?
Hey, Jamal.
My man, Jamal. All right.
Go ahead, Jamal.
All right. So, you know, as you know, my grandmother, who recently just passed away at 91.
Yeah, wow.
Right. So, she bought the house on Humboldt.
Yeah.
In 1948.
Wow.
Her and my grandfather.
Okay.
Now, at this time, this area was all Jewish.
Yep.
And Irish immigrants.
Yep.
Okay. So, bought the house from a Jewish family that was leaving, right? The Jewish flight.
Right.
First, because right. Roxbury and all that, and up to Mattapan, when my father and mother were little boys and girls and whatnot, you know, all up and down Blue Hill Avenue and whatnot was all these, you know, bakeries and cleaners and so on and so forth, and back when the trolley used to run up in there. But this was a predominantly Jewish community.
Yeah, yeah.
It would have been the Brookline of the day.
Yeah.
And in fact, the flight that happened is when they left and they went to Brookline, Newton, you know, so on and so forth.
Yeah.
My grandmother originally lived in the West End of Boston.
Okay.
Which is, as you know, behind the State House.
Right.
And is all that area of where, you know, Mass General and all this type of thing is now.
Mm-hmm.
And that entire area was completely, you know, brought down to the ground and then rebuilt. To rebuild that part of the city, and that's where they first, from that Beacon Hill and that West End thing.
Yeah, yeah.
Then left and so on and so forth.
Let's go back there, though. Let's go back. When they opened up the South End for us to go into the South End, how do I ask the question? Did we have the option of saying no? Because it sounds like what you just said, if they leveled, started taking things down, there was no other place for us to go other than the way they herd cattle. You go right into here.
Well, okay, some of these things are also just the effects of, you know, building a city, when a city is getting bigger.
Yeah.
And, you know, we're tearing down this section of the city. We're doing something different. You know, nobody lived in the seaport, for instance,
okay.
when they tore that down to build the seaport.
Yeah,
so there was no big moving of people.
Okay.
But had there been, that's how it goes.
Yeah,
you know, in East Boston, when it was time to build the airport or whatever, you know, there was expand the airport, rather. You know, people had to move. And, you know, Mel King, they fought when they were going to do the highway. So, you know, the highway still happened,
but
they just had to go another route.
Right.
You know,
right.
And create other things. The MBTA, when they took down the L train and they did the Southwest Corridor.
Yeah.
Right?
Yes.
All this type of stuff. And it leads to some stuff getting tore down, but it also leads to new stuff, you know, happening. It's like the season. Some of it is
ominous. And you know what? You're right, Jamal. You're right. It does lead to some new stuff happening, but one of the things that's not happening is, it's not being talked about, is the people that are being moved out of the neighborhoods that they traditionally had a stake in. You know what I'm saying? Because they could not afford it.
Okay, so now, this is the thing. So once again, our people, in my belief, we suffer from a false level of ownership.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Okay? I'll give you a couple examples now. The Harriet Tubman House.
Yeah.
Yep.
Harriet Tubman House is in dispute. A lot of people, because they have an emotional attachment to it. It's meant this to them over the years, and right? But yet we do not own it.
Right.
Right.
Therefore is why the discussion is that it can be sold or taken away without our za-da-da-da. A lot of these times we're fighting like Roxbury. Some people think that Roxbury is black. But see, I know better because, once again, my family, it was Jewish people could come back and say, we want our neighborhood back.
Right. We gave it to you for 70 years. We want it back.
Lenox Street and Orchard Park was white in the 50s.
This is what I'm saying. And some of our biggest icons.
Yeah.
Look, I was a child of the Elmer Lewis School.
Yeah.
you go to Elmer Lewis School now, which is now a church, which is the other part of what I want to talk to you about, Pastor Wall, which is what you was talking about.
Okay.
But, you know, so the black church ended up buying the Elmer Lewis School after it was dilapidated for years, right?
Yeah.
Okay. If you go up there now, back in the 70s or wherever, and you drive, right at what they call, in the Bible, the cornerstone.
Yeah.
You will go and you will see the Jewish writing, because it used to be the biggest temple in the city.
Now
the biggest temple in the city is, I forget what it's called, Bar Shalom or Bar Israel, whatever, over in Brookline or whatever.
Temple of Israel. Yeah. The Temple of Israel. The
Temple of Israel.
You brought the church from.
Yeah. Right, yeah. So Bar, I think Bar Israel, right. So they owned not only that front building where the Elmer Lewis School was on the Seaver side, but even the behind building.
The ones in the back where they redone over as well.
And then I believe even further down the street, which was for a long time a Christian Science thing, but now...
Sonoma and Maple.
Sonoma and Maple.
Homestead.
Elm Hill, it's further down.
It's further down, closer to Child Street.
Right before Groover's Church.
Right.
But right before, we were across the parking lot,
So I believe they own that too, and if they didn't own it, another temple did, because that's also a Jewish building.
Yeah.
And if you go throughout the hood in Dorchester, Mattapan, whatever, and you really look at the quote-unquote the cornerstone, you're going to see the Star of David, or you're going to see, you know, the Hebrew symbol for God. And most oftentimes, you know, you'll see it even up on the top of the rafters in the roof type of thing. And a lot of folks kept that, of course, because it wasn't, you know, it was satanic writing or something. It was, you know, it was congruent with the faith.
Right.
So folks kept it.
Yeah.
But it showed the Hebrew impact. And so we got a lot of our buildings because of the first Jewish flight.
Correct.
You know, and then even if we talk about the white flight now of a different time, the immigrants down Dudley, a big place. I brought the last poets there.
Yeah.
Hibernian Hall. What's Hibernian? That's an Irish function, you know, the ancient name for Irish people. But that was an Irish function hall. That was like their Prince Hall or whatever you want to say.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So
there's
a lot of this stuff.
Blair's
Market. Exactly. Yeah. You know, so this was a thriving community, long before it was Nubian Square, you know, it was mainly white control. Black people went there and spent their dollars. We didn't own a lot of stuff down there.
Right.
If you ever look at the movie that Billy Celeste gave me called Black Cop, I put it on YouTube.
Okay.
If you ever seen that.
Yeah.
It was a documentary done about the black officers of the time. And at one of those points, there's a merchants meeting down Dudley. With all the people, and they're talking about, you know, the pickpockets and the purse snatchers and the hubcap thieves. And it is almost literally exactly the same stuff we're going through now. You know, things have changed and whatnot. You know, nobody steals hubcaps anymore. Now they just take the whole car. So this gentrification thing, I just wanted to say, there was a couple of levels of white flight, a couple of things, and then two, for the black people, also note the wars. Once again, my family bought the house in 1948. My grandfather came out of the army, you know. My grandmother was a tap dancer and whatnot. So they put their little, you know, monies together and were able to buy that house back in 1948. Which is what? Just after World War II.
Mm-hmm.
World War II, yeah.
You know, so we got to think about the timelines and whatnot different. And when that happened, my grandmother, born in 1926, she was just 22 years old.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
Just 22 years old. My mother, 6 years old. 1942, during the war.
Well, Jamal, what was the condition of your grandmother's house before it was sold, like last year? What was the condition of the house? The overall?
I kept it good. So, you know, everything was good. You know, we had a new heating system in there. Mm-hmm. I mean, it wasn't like some of these new houses you go in and you see, and it's, you know, marble countertops. And, you know, we weren't ultra-modern Jetsons time. No, but everything in there was stable, and, you know, you know, obviously kept everything reasonably clean, and, you know, I mean, no problems, no rodent infestations, no insect infestations, no, you know, all the major stuff that you look for in a house. Foundation's good, no leaks. Just had got the roof done after that major storm we had.
So what was it? Did you turn that into a, was it a two-family house?
No, that was a three-family all the time.
Okay, so you had rents coming in from two apartments?
Well, at one point.
Okay, so why couldn't you have convinced the powers that be to keep it and keep upgrading so that you can have that property?
So now we get to a point of part of this gentrification thing, and I think this is a big part, and the churches could play a big part in this.
Okay.
Because, and some churches do. To have these classes and to host these classes on first-time
home buying,
financing, all this type of stuff.
Yeah.
Because, see, at the end of the day, and estate planning. So, at the end of the day, a lot of our seniors particularly are gullible for this. So, let me tell you. My grandmother, my aunt, my uncle, all the older ones, right?
Yeah, yeah.
What did they all watch on TV? You know, Matlock, Quincy, you know, Little House on the Prairie, you know, all those ones. And then late night on TV, all of the stars from those shows, Michael Landon, Ed Asner, they're all hawking something. And they're usually hawking reverse mortgages.
Right. Right.
Or they're hawking what do you call it? Living trusts and irrevocable trusts and all this type of they're giving out financial advice. And a lot of these old people are like, oh, well, Michael Landon wouldn't lie to me.
Right, right.
And then they're making the decisions at 1 o'clock in the morning when they can't sleep.
Yeah.
And they're watching these doggone infomercials.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And now it's giving them the new real estate approach, and now they got it all figured out. Okay, so my uncle got caught up like that, and he got caught up in a reverse mortgage. Okay? And at the time, you couldn't tell him nothing. They, you know, he had been convinced that a reverse mortgage was a good thing and this was great for you. Because it's alluring. Pay no money now.
Right. Right.
And we get everything later.
Right.
It's like Rumpelstiltskin. You got to give up your first kid or something.
Yeah.
Right? So that's alluring and it gets a lot of people.
Right. So I remember the trusts. I remember my grandfather coming back from World War II. His friends were, you know, his platoon sergeant was Mr. Cash. I don't know if you know Mr. Cash. He was from Progressive Barbershop.
Yes.
And then the Crispy's, the drugstore. Next door was the fruit stand, which is now a garden store. They sold plants. That was the fruit store. That was my grandfather. Those were all his friends. They were all World War II veterans. They all brought businesses together. They all put in together and brought businesses. One of the things we failed to do is we failed to give back to our young folk, our younger members, of how to have equity power in their neighborhood, with maybe getting brothers to pitch in and purchase property, just as though the other realtors are doing now, and continue to purchase property in their neighborhoods, so which gives us the equity power to move forward. A lot of folks don't trust each other, which we need to really get out of that stigma. And learn how to work with one another in terms of getting the equity power that we need in our neighborhood so that we can keep the people that would want to live here living here. What's your thoughts on that, fellas?
Think now, though, too, the bang for your buck. So my family, when they bought it back in the day, they bought their house for $10,000.
Woo!
Okay? Yeah. Nowadays, you're going to buy a house like that for bottom of the barrel, $850,000. Maybe, you know, if it's fully redone and all that, 1.1, 1.2 mil.
Right.
Okay, so now you bust your hump to get that money up, to get that mortgage, and now, so you just bought a house for 1.1 in Roxbury or something like that, right? That house is never going to be worth $3
million.
Like,
there's no future time in, you know, when we got hovercrafts and all that. You're not going to buy that house now in 2020 for $850,000 or $1 million. And in 2020 and 2030, it's going to be worth $3 million. There's no, we might be underwater by then. You know what I mean? Like literally underwater.
Right.
You know what I mean? So, like, it's the day of putting something in and getting something back, at least here in this place, Boston, is very difficult now because the prices are so high. You see what I mean? So now, should you advise if there's a young couple just starting out their life, you know, married and da-da-da-da, would you advise them to stay here and buy a house for $850,000?
Heck no.
Or would you say go to North Carolina and buy four houses?
Right. People are telling me, people are sending me pictures of their new homes outside of Boston, down south, for $200,000. They're still getting homes for $200,000. Beautiful, beautiful, spacious homes. That's where they're going.
And this is what I mean. And so now it's not just gentrification, but now it's black flight.
Mm-hmm.
Because at some point, black people who live in these urban environments, not just Boston, you lived in New York all your life or Chicago all your life.
Anything's happening in New York. Yeah.
It's everywhere. Any urban environment. And now people are looking for greener pastures elsewhere. You see what I'm saying?
Right.
And you want your kids to grow up in an environment where they can actually play in the backyard maybe without the fear of getting shot.
Hmm.
Where, you know, all these types of things, you know, your job up here, you're just a regular cog in the machine up here, but you go somewhere else, you're a big shot.
Mm.
You're a big wig.
Mm.
You know what I mean? So these different types of things, you know, you're living in a three-bedroom apartment with your kids or whatever, you go somewhere else and you have a multi-level, you know, looking like you're a bench warmer for the NBA.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
It's a big difference in terms of lifestyle and all of this, and you know, and then people just want peace of mind. Once again, Boston, with the reputation for being the most racist, or at least in the top 10 or top 5 most racist places for whatever, I know that when I left here, I physically felt a there was literally a relief when when I left here.
Wow.
And even when I was out of America, it was even deeper, because then it was really gone.
Mm-hmm.
Like, was that when I was in Canada?
Mm-hmm.
Oh my gosh!
Mm.
But Boston, when I left, it was a thing. And so a lot of people too who leave here are leaving here because, you know, look, take me as an example. As you know, wonderful as I'm supposed to be or whatever, I can't make no. I'm not living high on the hog in Boston.
Yeah, yeah.
Go somewhere else, once again, I could be a big shot.
Mm.
But only because of my, you know, sick addiction or
well, you stayed. You stayed for
stay here.
You stayed for your grandmother, though, at first. You were here.
I stayed for my grandmother and to make a difference in the city. That's,
okay.
You know, both of those reasons is why I came back.
Okay.
You know, grandma, make a difference for the city, blah, blah, blah. Now grandma is gone. Difference in the city. I'm no longer as confident as there can be a difference
here. It's the change. I feel like it caught me off guard. Years ago in the 80s, when I was sleeping in those drug houses, I said to a police officer, I said, you know what, I feel like I'm not really doing this for my people. I feel like the people that are going to benefit from this work are going to be white folk moving back in there. I saw it way back then, but
it was coming.
Yeah, but there's no way.
At that time, if you looked at what was going on in the South End, I could definitely agree to that. And how the South End changed, the South End just took flight. Period.
There was no defense. Yeah. There was no way for us to stay in the South End and to beat this gentrification thing. Don't you think some people saw it back then?
Oh, yeah. I mean, that video I sent you, that video was super old, and gentrification has been a subject, you know, since then. And not for nothing, too, Boston was primed with gentrification. You know, if you're going to do the history, remember that at one point, Boston was the number one arson city in the country, right?
Mm.
Yep, okay. So that's all part of gentrification, because if I can't get them out, I know how to get them out.
Right.
Okay.
Right.
So burn, baby, burn. And everything was burning, and people were collecting double insurance,
mm-hmm.
and everything else. And it was a really windfall for a bunch of absentee landlords, you know, pseudo construction and development companies and whatnot who burned a lot of residential properties, storefronts, and all. Remember, the entire track on Humboldt between my street, Roofman, and Homestead,
I remember.
Was all those old brick apartments and with the storefronts on the bottom.
Yeah, yeah.
That entire block was engulfed in flames, and then comes in the rebuilding.
I remember.
And isn't that beautiful?
Yeah.
When we get paid in the beginning, we get paid in the middle, then we get insurance because of the fire, and any of my equipment that burned up on site, I get paid for that too. So let me make sure my old lift is there, my old equipment is there, got burnt up, because now I'm getting brand new stuff. These people had quite the hustle for years, decades.
Yeah.
You know, I had the opportunity of going into Elmer Lewis's house. These new owners now, nice white folk, they had allowed me to go in. There was 8 rooms in that house, and it doesn't even look like it.
Wow. Wow.
And at the corner of Walnut and, I forgot the name of the street. Walnut and, make a long story short, I got a chance to go into the house, man. Her nephew had it for a long time, but he really wasn't the owner of the property, and they got him out of there, and then they sold the house. The house went up for sale.
That's crazy. That is crazy.
I couldn't believe it. You know, he was living on the second floor, from what the owners were telling me, that the Elmer Lewis's nephew was living on the second floor. It's a beautiful chandelier in her dining room area. Unbelievable. A real big, huge chandelier. You can't believe there's that much room in that house, but it was beautiful, man.
So how do you guys define this eminent domain when the city says, we're going to give you this amount of money, market rate, or this amount of money for your property because we need this land? They've done that. They did a lot of that, didn't they?
They did.
That was during the highways and that's going to be something major, Big Dig or something like that.
Yeah.
I remember there was one lady during the Big Dig who held out on her little house on the corner, and I think they ended up building around it, and then it just ended up falling and disappear. I think it's still there. It looks like a haunted house now.
Right. Down by the Whittier housing development that's, no longer there, there's a church hosted, led by Reverend Sam Hogan. They stood their ground, and whatever they did, they had to do it around the church. But the church looks like it's also in disarray, and I just think that eventually they're going to cave. They're going to give in and cave.
Oh, they just smoke you out. They wait you out. You on the timetable. They not on the timetable.
Right.
They already started getting out the old Whittier Street building. If you look, you see there's just the shell.
I'm shocked that
along with the building that they're doing around it, changing the Whittier Street projects. They're eventually Bishop Hogan will, they will be looking for that land as well.
Wow.
You know,
and now watch this too. The last time the eminent domain would have been applicable for us in our community was around the discussion when the Olympics was coming, if you remember this. So when the Olympics was coming, anything that was going to be Franklin Park adjacent all along that Seaver would have been taken over for athlete housing and this type of thing. So all of those people along Seaver Street, from Blue Hill Ave to Walnut, at least, would have been subjected to that.
I agree with you. I remember that. That would have been so totally insane that all of those people would have been moved out of that area. That is insane.
It's something I want to study because, in that video that I sent you, one of the things that I put was when I was, younger, coming up, Academies was just so massive to me. Sometimes I used to be hanging out in Academies, and I used to just look around and be like, this is crazy.
Mm.
You know, just like, this is massive. This is stacks on stacks on stacks of people in all these buildings. You know, when you go up to the top of Academies, up on the hill, you know what I mean?
Right.
Mm-hmm.
And, in the projects, and some of my dudes who was on the top, and, the view, and I was like, whoa, this is crazy up here. And then the Roxbury Rocks and all that type of stuff, and, you know, that pudding stone. Man, it was just such a crazy area, how many people. And then when I was a kid, remember when they completely did academies over?
Yeah.
Yep. And they had to move everybody from academies, was gone. They tore down everything.
That was in 78.
No. This is in 80s, man. This is the 80s. The crack was out because I was still...
You mean the light, the Calvin Park side, you mean?
Yeah, up on the hill.
That was in the 80s. Because in 87, I was one of the laborers on the MBTA taking down the tracks for 87. We worked nights from 12 to 7 in the morning taking down the MBTA tracks from the Washington Street area.
Well, again, one of the reasons why I want to have this conference is... Yeah, I love this discussion this morning because I've been here. I'm 71 years old. When I was on living on Maple Street, the Jewish community used to ask me to come into their homes on Saturday and turn off the lights and turn off their stoves, and it was crazy. And when I walked up Elm Hill Avenue trying to go to Franklin Park, I didn't feel like they made you feel like you don't belong there. You know. And we just want to utilize your services. That's all changed. And the churches that are in these storefronts that they don't own, these owners are going to be selling these storefronts, and you're going to see more churches going. And so what are they going to do? What are their congregations going to do? Are we going to see the death of the church in the city of Boston?
I think the church is going to have to evolve. I think that, you know, just by the nature of what we're doing, I think, so for instance, what you're doing now, your new church might not even meet. Your new church might be a virtual church. You see what I'm saying?
No building.
Exercise people.
Right.
You know, there's you know, no more we go to the gym and get on the bike. Now there's Peloton. We sell you a big bike and you log in and... You know, we're right there, guiding you through it. Look, you could pray for people. You know what I mean? Take them off into a special room, the whole thing. Mm-hmm. But I think the technology and just that the nature of how human interaction is happening is I think that less and less places of gathering are become. Hey, look, even in the secular world, bars ain't doing what they used to do.
Huh.
People are not going out to drink at a place for drinking the way that they used to. You know, there's no more video stores. Like, certain points of ways where there was human interaction are changing, and I think that's going to happen. You know, so no, you're not going to be allowed to be Blockbuster Video anymore. Mm-hmm. You're going to have to adapt into Netflix or die.
Yep.
And that's where the church is going. You know, the church is going to have to adapt into a new way of delivering the message, because the old way with these huge palatial estates and all of that type of stuff, it's not economical. It's not, I don't think it's serving people. It's not really, you know, people aren't into it like they used to be. And people want to get that message on the go. And, you know, to go back to 12th Baptist Church, right?
Yeah.
You remember after every sermon, remember, Michael E. Haynes had them white tapes.
Okay, yeah.
You remember that?
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So you could get, this is when any major church you went to worth its salt, when you left, you can get a cassette tape of the message.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Exactly. But see, so now cassette tapes ain't a thing no more.
No.
So now, if you worth your salt, now it's YouTube.
Mm-hmm.
Now it's whatever. Yeah. And that is going to be, in my view, that is going to be the way that you all are going to be forced to go, because I don't believe that the brick and mortar church is going to work anymore.
Right.
Whew. Whew. So this whole thing on gentrification, maybe this I can't do it for this conference because we're a couple of weeks away, but maybe the whole new phase of looking at this is talking to churches about the alternative to what they're doing now to their reaching people. And maybe what we're doing here at Boston Press Radio and TV, because you're right, Jamal, I was saying to our folk, we don't have CDs anymore upstairs in the balcony. We don't have cassettes, obviously. Everything is all, we send all of our services to YouTube, as you just said, and people just go in and they watch it at their leisure. So, you know, we've been on the apex of this whole thing without even knowing that we are. So, right. Interesting conversation, guys. Interesting conversation.
So, you know, they have a website now that tells you where all the black churches are today in Boston, and services.
Is that churchline.com?
I think so. I think, like, you know, when folks come to visit the city,
yeah,
they have a website that you can go to, and it talks about the churches, what they do, what denomination they are,
wow,
and things of that nature. They have a new app that folks can go on in the hotels now.
I'll check that
and
out.
Jamal, that makes sense, Jamal.
My last comment, I've got a couple of minutes. Do you guys know what's going on and what's happening in Detroit as it relates to property and buildings and homes? Are they going through a major transformation in Detroit?
There's a lot of places, you know, that experience these things. And if you see online, it'll say, you know, buy a building for $10 or $1 or what have you.
Yeah, yeah.
So Detroit, you know, Baltimore and all that. But a lot of those things have a lot of contingencies on it. But, yeah, there are a lot of opportunities in Detroit.
Yeah.
What have you.
Detroit's making a comeback.
Oh,
but once again, you got to make sure if you buy, you know, let's say you go elsewhere and you buy a strip mall.
Yeah.
Okay, there's a reason that strip mall closed, first of all.
Yeah.
And you buy a strip mall, now you got a strip mall, and you can't attract no businesses to get in the strip mall.
Right.
Or
right.
You can't attract nobody to your strip mall. So, you know, it's hit or miss. And when people buy any type of property, whether it's business or residential, I always, you know, caution people to just do your due diligence, because, you know, you can buy a dud. There's a lot of duds out there.
Yeah.
You know.
That's right.
Well, guys, thanks for helping me think this through. I really appreciate it. I've got to finalize a lot of work on this conference, but I appreciate your time this morning. I had two great co-hosts, and you guys helped me out tremendously. I appreciate it.
I just want to ask Jamal, what was that, the black coat or black cops that Billy Sylvester had?
Yeah, black cop. If you search black cop on YouTube, you'll find that video.
Yeah, I'd like to take a look at that. Brothers, I appreciate y'all, man, and may God continue to bless you all.
Okay.
And, Reb, I appreciate you, man. Thank you for giving us the opportunity, man, to air out some of our junk, so to speak. God bless you guys, and thank you very much.
Okay, thank you. Bye-bye, Jamal.
Peace.
Okay. Well, that was a great conversation. It really helped stimulate my thinking regarding the conference that we want to host here on Boston Praise Radio and TV. The conference is entitled The Status of the Black Church in Boston in the Midst of the Gentrification of the City. The Status of the Black Church in Boston in the Midst of the Gentrification of the City. And I would dare say that the condition of our churches in Boston is troubling, because I do not believe that a lot of our church folk have really sat down and thought through, where are we going as a church? Are we going to stay on this corner? What will our neighborhood look like in the next 10 to 15 years? We need to slow down a lot of the other things that we're doing, and we need to have these conversations, because I've asked myself the question, should we stay in this building, this huge building that we have to heat, this huge building that needs $500,000 to $700,000 worth of renovations? Should we stay in this building, or should we sell all of our property? But the big question is, where do you go? And you can't make that decision in 1 year. it takes years to think this through, because when you sit with one team of people and begin to have discussions about the future of your church, some of the people in that meeting, in that circle, they die, they leave the church, they move away. So it takes longer than 1 year or 2 years to really think this through and to come up with a comprehensive plan that's going to help you to see what the future looks like and to move your congregation into that future. We're going to be back in a few moments, and when I come back, we're going to switch from talking about the gentrification conference, and we're going to be talking about forgiveness. Can you forgive? Is there a need for you to forgive? We're going to talk about forgiveness at the 8 o'clock hour. Stay there. We shall be right back.